Hi there, everybody. This is James LeBrance, and I have a subject that is often uncomfortable for people, but it's something that a lot of people do need to hear because it is a very widespread problem. It's not something that just attaches itself, and in the case of Christians, we believe it literally attacks us. And that's sexual sin, deviance, pornography is what I'm talking about today, but there are many sexual deviances. Now, this one is major, though, and the reason being that, the internet is one reason. In fact, probably the most major reason you can think of. And, of course, people's iPhones and their iPads and so forth are even other ways that they watch it, just having porn on their cable stations that they'll sign up for, and they'll watch it there and so forth. So just mostly viewing of films that are either videos or movies and so forth that are on television or whatever the case, magazines. You know, magazines haven't gone away, but they're very less popular now than is the ready-made, ever-available pornography online. Now, let me begin this also by saying that I am a recovered porn addict that was in this hellish cycle of horrible ashamedness and just feeling raunchy and dirty about myself, and yet I was in ministry during some of these years that I was into the pornography. Sometimes I had victories for a while, and then it would come back upon me. And you say, but that can't be the case. Well, I'm fixing to read to you statistics that show that over half of pastors are watching pornography. Over half, not half, but over half. Okay. That is stunning, a stunning statistic that's very alarming as well. I'm going to read some other very alarming statistics that some people will wish they didn't have to hear, but you know what? Don't close your eyes to something that's destroying people's lives, okay? Now, some people are absolutely, they just love porn, and they, so to speak, they think they do, and it definitely doesn't love them back. It destroys their psyche. It can destroy their marriage. It can destroy their children. It can do all these things. It can destroy their lives, you know, their own lives, and so forth. It can cause people to become suicidal over time, and so forth. And it can cause them to venture into other sexual deviances. And you say, did you, James LeBrance, if you were porn addicted? I was porn addicted, but no, I did not. I never ventured into such as adultery or what is also called fornication, which can be any kind of sexual sin, in my opinion. No, I did not. I was heterosexual into adult pornography, and that's what it always was. If there was anything else, I would say so. You know, I'm that kind of person. Now, I've had even people in my family say, you know, I don't know about that openness thing, about telling everything about yourself and so forth. Well, they're not as interested in helping people as I am, apparently. And you can say, we can do it in a different way. Well, the statistics, and I will talk about the Bible too here in a little bit. Statistics show that there's only about a 7% effort by churches, you know, Christian churches, to address the problem of pornography. So who's going to do it? And who's going to step forward and say, hey, it almost destroyed my life. Don't let it happen to you. Okay? It's like people at AA meetings, Alcoholics Anonymous, they'll step up in front of everybody, stand up and say, I'm an alcoholic. Okay? Well, some people need to let it be known. Now, see, in Christianity, we believe anything can be delivered from anything through God's power. Nothing is impossible to God. Now, I'm going to tell you something right now that's just an admittance in regard to my life after pornography. Have I occasionally come across things online. Yes. Did, and you know what? My wife heard this one time in a message. She said, well, you've said you were delivered from that. And I said, I've told you before. I'm still a human man. I'm still a red-blooded American man. And I said, if there's very indecency of dress around me, and it kind of surrounds me, I can't even look a certain direction like when I'm in a department store during summertime with my wife. She does the shopping, and I follow along. That's pretty much about how it goes. And she helps me even to kind of select specials on clothing and stuff that looks good, like this shirt and so forth, and I have even better ones than this. But I have quite a few of these types of things that are pullover, button-up in the front shirts and pants, you know, sometimes dress clothes and so forth. And she helps me with that and stuff. It's not like I'm being a little boy who can't decide for myself, but I like the touch she gives things, shopping and so forth too, just all around. And so I depend on her for things like that. Could I do it alone? Of course I could, but I don't want to. I have her, and I praise God for her. She's a wonderful, precious woman of God. And when I confessed to her about 20 years ago that I had a problem with pornography, but that I was seeking God's deliverance in the most powerful way I had ever in my life, because I began to have illnesses that came on my body. Okay, well, James Lawrence, are you saying that these illnesses may have been a direct result of you having been in pornography? I do indeed. Okay, now let me explain to you why. Well, there's quite a few different reasons why. For one thing, the Bible says in Galatians chapter 1, and I believe it's somewhere between verses 7 and 9, but anyway, it says, "Be not deceived. God is not mocked. For whatsoever a man soweth, that shall he also reap." Okay, so if you sow to yourself the sin of fornication, which comes in many different categories, I mean, but pornography is so major that people actually are doing that as opposed to, I guess that's good that they're not doing some of the other horrible things they could be doing. And like I say, it never caused me to go on to anything else, because to me that was the thing that I was going to be involved in. But praise God, thank you Jesus, that he has delivered me. Now I'm going to give you a quick testimony right here, because Jesus Christ can deliver you from these things. And if you're a Christian especially, you should know, and you should study up, pray a lot, go to people that can be a confidant. However, be very cautious about that, because I've gone to a couple of people that were confidants. So in other words, you tell things in confidence and you say, can you please, you know, can I indulge you to you my problem? And can I depend on you to keep it between us? They may say no. Move on to someone else. You know, there's some people you know explicitly that you can trust. You just know it. It can be a family member. And you know for a fact, say your dad or somebody like that, and they're not going to spread things. Not about their own son. Now, some dads might that are not too good of dads, you know, not very good fathers to their sons, but a lot of us do know when we can depend on dad, we can depend on our spouse, although in a lot of cases, be cautious there too, okay? And you must approach it maybe through a pastor and say, can you please come with me and talk to the pastor with me, or a Christian counselor and things. I've never been to a Christian counselor over this problem, although I did go to one with my wife. Really, it had to do with some things that were affecting both of us that had nothing to do with our marriage. It was on the outside. Okay, and that's all I want to say about that. But we went about five different times. There was someone who sort of requested that we do as well, and so we were doing it for their sake as well. And but things were good, and she said, I don't feel I really need to be seeing you. And so she gave advice that several other people did as well, that we needed to walk away from a certain situation. And we've tried to stay true to that, although my wife is the one who, you know, she's a little bit more, she's so loving to people that she cannot stand not to wait for the true repentive relationship with someone to start to begin happening. She will see them and she just falls apart. And because she's a wonderful woman, she has a great heart on the inside. But see, I know as a man, I have to wait until things can be brought back together in a godly way. Otherwise, if it doesn't come in a godly way, it's not gonna, that's not gonna take, okay? It just doesn't happen. But what I was talking about being a confidant, like I went to some people about my problem with pornography, and indirectly, someone who knows me knew about it as well, and someone pretty close, but this sounds terrible, but I don't want it to sound like I'm putting a threat out there or something like that to someone, but they've acted like at times that they were going to expose my problem. Well, I've done that already in multiple videos about my porn problem, but they act like other things may be attached to it. Okay, let me just say it, masturbation. Okay, and that they know about that, and they also know that at times when I couldn't be alone, I had two kids and a wife at home, that I would go out in my car and I would look at a porn magazine or something like that because I needed that fix, like addicts say about drugs. And yes, it was that bad. It was really that bad. So anyway, and they know about that, but you know, I know something too. And it regards something they told me as well. Now, I would never come forward to other people with this. I've told my wife and that's it. That's it. But you know, talking about someone needing help, if when it's been years ago that they were delivered, and bringing up a past sin, do you do that to people? No, you don't. Okay, and I'll tell you a story here in a little bit. Oh man, I hope I don't forget that. Let me write it down here. Oops, I'm shaking my camera. Sorry about that. I'm sorry, I'm laughing at my own note there. Sometimes I can't even read them myself. Okay, now, let me read you some statistics I took off of some online sites, but they're such short quotes that I know these Christian sites especially aren't going to mind. And these statistics show up elsewhere. Other people are using them. I would not read a passage, literally, from an article without permission. But I can quote one short, like just a sentence? Yes. Or two, even. Two or three. I think they say up to 50 words is usually acceptable with most people. But let me start with Covenant Eyes. It's a Christian site stating that 51% of male students and 32% of female students first viewed porn before their teenage years. Before their teenage years. This article was updated year 2022. Now, webroot.com, a non-Christian one. I'm going to put a couple of non-Christian, or there could be Christian people involved, you know what I mean. That's usually the case, but it's not specifically a Christian website, but it says at webroot.com that one-third of porn viewers are women. Article updated year 2022. Now, I'm going to pick on men too here in just a minute, so hold your horses if you're starting to say, how dare you talk about women? Yes, the sanctity of womanhood and motherhood has been protected for a long time, but now we have to look at realities because people are suffering from these things, okay, because of online porn. It is a horrible, demonic, satanic tool that is bringing people down by huge numbers, so to speak. I mean, it's just bringing them down. Some are committing suicide. They're going into addictions, you know, because of it and so forth, other addictions, but it just adds to their problem. It doesn't, it just masks it, and then they have yet another problem. So it says in Psychology Today, of viewers to the most popular porn sites, 32% are female. That was specifically an article from June 1st, 2020. Mission Frontiers, another Christian site, says 33% of women aged 25 and under search for porn at least once per month. Only 13% of self-identified Christian women say they never watch porn. Only 13% say they never watch porn. 87% of Christian women have watched porn. That was from November 1st, 2020, in Mission Frontiers online Christian magazine. Proven Men, another Christian website, says nearly 4 in 10, or 38%, of men first viewed pornography before turning age 12. So now I'm talking about male statistics. 64% of men view porn at least once a month, and it only drops down to 54% that are born-again Christian men. That only drops by that percentage, by 10%. So it's 64% of people who do not claim Christianity, 54% of born-again Christian men view pornography at least once a month. Article from updated year 2022. Okay, Charisma News. Now, I'm not saying I agree with everything that's on all these Christian sites, although probably I do, likely. But I'm just saying it's a statistic, and it is taken from surveys done of Christian people as well as just people who are secular, they're not really into religion and so forth. Okay, it says 70% of Christian youth pastors report. Did I say Charisma News? Okay, yes I did. 70% of Christian youth pastors report that they have had at least one teen come to them for help in dealing with pornography in the last 12 months. 68% of church-going men and over 50% of pastors view porn on a regular basis. That article as well, updated year 2022. So I read three statistics from that one, Charisma News. I'm going to read scriptures here in just a moment. But folks, you know why this problem of pornography is not being addressed by very many people? One very major reason is embarrassment, period. Embarrassment, okay? And even if they're, sorry, I'm squeaking in my chair. So that's one reason, but also because look how many pastors are watching pornography on a regular basis, over 50% of pastors. Are they going to address a porn problem in their church? Not when they have guilt about it themselves. They'd have to put themselves in the program first if they're going to lead by example. Okay, I'm kind of leading by example by telling you about my porn addiction. And of course, I mentioned masturbation. I read a young woman's site, or her, I'm sorry, I watched her video and read her description on the site too. And it was on a YouTube video, and she talked about her porn and self-copulation problem. And I commented on it, and I said, I appreciate you coming forward. I said, I've done the same thing, and you might enjoy some of my videos that I pointed her toward. But you know, some people, they won't do it. Hey, as long, if I get delivered, all right, you know, praise God. I'm not going to tell anybody. Why would I do that? Embarrass myself. Well, for the sake of someone who may be suffering the same addiction that you did. Okay, but there's a lot of people who won't do that. Embarrassment and so forth. Okay, just not wanting to, just not caring enough to do it. Okay? I got to tell you the story. I'm going to read some scriptures. Now, please don't hang up on me here. But hold out. Hold on. Don't give out. I assure you this is going to be interesting. You know, I told this story in one of my things about my porn addiction videos that I did, and I couldn't find it. And I've searched. I've looked at videos, and I can't find it. So this is one I may have discontinued off of my YouTube channel, like I will the old one I did on this subject. And I'm going to have a different image, a nice one. But it's not going to be the same. Not really based the same and so forth. It's a little differently. But I had some grown-up people I had confided with. You know how I talked about confidants? I had confided with two of these family members about my problem. Man, I was desperate for help, folks. I wrote to 10 Christian men one time. I got a response from one. And he only responded because he said, I'm having exactly the same problem as you. And he was a minister of a church. At that time, I think he was an evangelist. Anyway, but then he settled down and he started pastoring a church. Okay, so in this other case, I have these two people here close to me and related to me. And they and my mother, my dad, their wives, plus a daughter of one of them, was in this room. They wanted to do kind of like an intervention for me. Okay, there are some things you can do that with. Sexual sin when there's mixed company? I don't think so. Okay, so was that the right thing for them to do? I think the answer is very obvious. No. Okay, but anyway, they were, you know, in the living room of some folk that are family. And when I came in the door, one of them spoke up, and I know they'd been talking, so this wasn't just this person's idea. And they're passed away now. God bless them. One of the people I've loved the most in the whole world. But anyway, they were together, and they brought up a story about a guy who was arrested because he was masturbating in his car. And he was, but he was parked at a place, I think it was a fast food place, but he was actually in one of the stalls, like a Sonic restaurant. And he was doing this, and they took him to jail. Indecent exposure. You know, indecent exposure. And I think it's a misdemeanor, however, what an embarrassing thing. I think it has to be slightly more serious for you to be labeled as a sex offender. However, that could be different in different states. Please know that. And anyway, they started talking to me about this, and I said, oh, really? I said, well, that's too bad for him. And I said, I really hate to hear of somebody doing something like that. And I thought, I am not about to let anyone even talk to me about this. I'm going to say, hey, if a couple of you men or all of you men want to talk to me, that's fine. We're not going to do it in mixed company. We're not going to do it with a teenager in the room. How pathetic could it get? Now, folks, this was a mistake, and I don't know how they couldn't recognize that before they made the mistake, but I'm sure some of them realize it was now. I'm sure they do. But that was, I'll just say it was a pathetic thing to do, and it was wrong, period. No two ways about it. Wrong. It was wrong. Okay? Because for one thing, the people were supposed to be confidants, but they may thought and said to each other, he's going to destroy his life. Well, yes. But you know what? You got to approach it still from the point of view of very firm Christianity. You don't do it in mixed company unless it's just my wife. She would have. Would she have? Probably, yes. Yes. I don't think I'd confess to her at that time. But she had an idea that I was struggling with pornography. So, on and off. And so she did know. I think she would have. So anyway, that happened, and just realize that if you're a confidant, be a confidant. If you want to check on somebody, that's fine. And I did have one of them that was checking on me pretty regularly. Are things going okay and stuff? I appreciated that, but the intervention thing that they were also involved in, wow, that was in outer space, you know? Okay, so just remember, if you're going to counsel someone, do so in a very Christian manner. Be cautious how you do it. Don't do something to somebody that may cause them to go off and commit suicide. And you say, oh, that can't happen. Oh, but yes, it can. If they think enough people know about something private in their lives like that, and that they're telling it around and stuff, yes, they could feel like, I can't face anybody anymore. So don't make no mistake about it. Yes, it could do that. Okay, now let me read these scriptures to you. I wanted to keep this somewhat short. 1 Corinthians chapter 6, verse 18 says this about sexual sin. It calls it fornication. And some people distinguish, well, fornication is outside of marriage, but it's still sexual sin and so forth. I think it's talking about all sexual sin. Be not deceived. God is not mocked. For whatsoever a man sows, that shall he also reap. Okay, this says, flee fornication. Every sin that a man doeth is without the body. But he that committeth fornication sinneth against his own body. I got another slight note here. I'm going to probably shake my camera again. I thought it was on strong foundation. It actually kind of is. I don't know why that's shaking, because this is a solid desk it's on. So maybe it's not pushed against the wall. We'll look at that later. Proverbs 6:32 says something very similar. But whoso committeth adultery with a woman lacketh understanding. He that doeth it destroyeth his own soul. Whew, that's very powerful. Matthew chapter 5, verse 27 and 28. Ye have heard that it was said by them of old, thou shalt not commit adultery. But I say unto you, this is Jesus speaking, but I say unto you that whosoever looketh on a woman to lust after her hath committed adultery with her already in his heart. Certainly, that goes for women lusting after men. Okay. Anyone who would argue that is kind of being foolish, so we're not going to get into that. But, you know, I talked about earlier about some of the illnesses that I developed. You know, just having horrible stress from something and being depressed, they say that that alone can bring on, it can bring on illnesses in your body. That's the truth. Terrible, terrible stress, depression, and so forth. And a lot of times, that's what these types of things like addictions will bring upon you. Now, Paul talked about a thorn in his flesh. Okay, Paul the Apostle, the greatest writer in the New Testament of the epistles, or Paul's. Okay, and he's the greatest writer of those epistles. And they are just teachings to different churches and preached messages written down, sent to them, and they're shared with us today under the New Testament. And they're fantastic. Well, I love Paul's. I love Peter's. I love James's. I love John's, 1st, 2nd, 3rd John. I like all the ones that Paul wrote to the different churches, and they're just fabulous. But he said he had a thorn in the flesh, a messenger of Satan sent to buffet him. Now, some people say, a messenger of Satan, that's like a demon or a devil, isn't it? Precisely. Okay, God would allow something like that come upon you? No, you're allowing it. And then God is giving permission to you because you have allowed it. Now, a thorn in the flesh, Paul said he had that, and he was coming to God and asking for him to remove it. He came to God three times. And God said, well, he said no, even though there are certain denominations that say no. He wasn't saying no. He's saying, why, bless God, Paul, you have the faith. You remove it. You don't think Paul would have known that he could remove that if he could? He healed many other people as a vessel of God. He didn't do it himself. God's power. Many, many times over. And other types of miracles. Prophecies and things like that. That he would give. And it was under God's Holy Spirit power. The Holy Ghost. He's also called. Now, I believe that, as it says, be not deceived. God is not mocked. For whatsoever a man sows, that shall he also reap. I believe that reaping process will happen in the flesh as well as in the spirit. Does God sometimes grant some people not having to have that reaping in the flesh? Yes, sometimes. It depends on how far they take it and if they've begun to tempt God. Tempting God means you're trying to get by with it for as long as you can, as far as you can go with it, and so forth. And then eventually God says, enough's enough, and you're going to have to learn from this. If God doesn't let people learn from those types of things that can hurt them and even destroy them, what kind of a God is that? It'd be like a parent that doesn't punish his child for doing extremely bad wrong that could eventually lead to them going to prison when they get older in their life. You see what I'm saying? You don't want to go to that prison that's apart from God, be separated from him for eternity in a place of punishment. No, you don't. So sometimes we have thorns in the flesh that will come upon us. And sometimes God heals us of those things, but sometimes they ride along in our lives. You say, why would God be unrighteous to do that? He's not at all being unrighteous. You brought it on, and he's allowing it. It's just like people say, I can't believe in that God who would allow all these evil things to happen in the world. Well, guess what? God allows them because man allowed them first. It was man that brought sin into the world. And it's man that developed these different sins like pornography. Okay? And it's destroying. It has destroyed our nation. It already has. Now, can we see some recoup from it? Possibly, but you know what? I don't think there's time. I think God is going to send his son, Jesus Christ, back to first rapture us up who are Christians. In other words, the resurrection of our bodies. Then we won't have these corruptible things that we wanted in our bodies. But that's not until he comes in the clouds and brings us up, the living and dead Christians. And then later he comes back, and we come back with him, the Bible says. And that's why I wonder why some people say, well, Christians will be here during all that great tribulation, including the Battle of Armageddon. No, the Bible says that God hath delivered us from the wrath to come. And it also says, it says it a different way too. For God hath not appointed us to wrath, but to receive Jesus Christ as Lord and Savior. I paraphrase a little. That's what it says. Okay. So anyway, that's pretty much all I was going to say, folks. And I almost was reluctant to bring up that story about the supposed intervention because it was gone about in a very wrong way. And I love them all, and I do not have a grudge. I don't have a grudge. I love them. I love them to pieces. And I always will, forever. And have I forgiven them? Of course, of course. You know, they were just badly mistaken, you know. And I hope that's all there was involvement. However, they'll have to answer to God themselves for that. Was it really to put me down so that they could feel bigger, some of them? I don't know. I don't really need to ponder that now because I've gone past it. Now, this one person that I said knows about some things and talking about I need help still and stuff. I know something about them too. Would I ever say something to somebody about this thing? No. However, I would remind them, do you remember when you told me this certain thing? And then I'd have to say, you and I are both sinners. You choose not to believe in God or to come to God for salvation through Jesus Christ. I have. You will bring up a past sin because you're wanting to put me down with it. Do I need to bring up a past sin to make you feel bad in your own heart about what you told me that occurred with you? They'll probably have not remembered it. They'll probably search in their mind if they've guessed who they are. What did I tell him? What did I tell him? Well, pretty bad thing. Okay, so anyway, no, it doesn't have to do with drugs or addiction in those areas. It just has to do with something that I had to encourage them about. So, anyway, no, I wouldn't bring it up to anybody publicly, but to them, yes, I would. Yes, I would have to. But it's not something I have to forgive. It's just something they told me about. If you use people's past sins against them, God is very displeased with you. Do not do it. Do not bring up sins or try to buffet people with sins that you know for a fact that they've confessed to God in true repentance and just true brokenness. If you're not broken over your sin, literally broken over it, you're not really repenting. You're testing God. Oh, Lord, I did this sin again. I sure do want to keep from going to hell. You'll forgive me again, won't you? Yeah, I know you will. You're a merciful God. And you know what? He probably will. But God does reach a limit, just like people have a limit to their breaking point. Days of Noah. God's breaking point was reached then too. It was sexual sin galore of every type. You can think of bestiality and things like that. And also that means animals involved. Horrible. Yeah. Probably children involved. And then angel worship that became an intermarrying of angels with human women. Now you say, James Lawrence, well listen, I'm not going to go into that right now. Look at my one about angel men in the Old Testament, an Old Testament fact. Okay, there are preachers, you'd be amazed, from every denomination that believe that it happened, that that occurred, and it's in the original language. It's showing it there too, but it did happen. And it was a sin in which God told Noah, I'm not going to strive with man. He's flesh too. He's flesh as well as being a spirit. So he's flesh too. Spirit and flesh. And he said, but I will give him 120 years to mend his ways. Now, some people aren't seeing that in that scripture, but that's what it's saying. And some translations say that exactly, that God gave man 120 years. And Noah began preparing the ark at about 20 years into that. So for about 100 years, they were preparing the ark or so. And so God flooded the earth so that the lineage of mankind would not be defiled by this mixed race of what is never supposed to happen. You say, but angels can't marry or intermarry, right? But you'll need to listen. You'll have to listen to my other video to know about that, okay? I don't want to keep going into it and then make this a whole nother subject on top of one that I've already covered. So thank you for listening. And folks, listen, your prayers for me would be appreciated very much. If you're watching this and you can pray for me, God bless you. I will receive it. I want it. And I will pray for you guys generally, because I don't know you all. You see me, I don't see you, but I can still pray because God knows all of your needs. And I will pray specifically for those who view these videos, but also generally for everybody, but especially those who view the videos, because they're searching. They're searching for answers to one thing or another, or maybe the big answer, Jesus Christ, and Him crucified, Him raised from the dead. Believe that, and you can be saved if you will come to God in true repentance. Turn your life around in Him, because there's literally a renewing of your spirit, and you receive the power of the Holy Ghost to be engrafted into the body of Christ that's called on earth, or baptized into the body of Christ by the Holy Ghost. Okay, so God's Spirit will dwell with you forever, and Jesus, His own presence, will dwell with you forever through the power of the Holy Ghost. Now, this, I know some of this can get confusing, but God is wonderful. And Jesus said, I will never leave you nor forsake you. So what does that mean? Never, ever will He ever leave us. So God bless you for hearing. I'll end on that gracious and happy note. Praise God. You know, be gracious to people. Be forgiving toward them, please. Please be forgiving toward them. And if you need to ask someone else forgiveness, make sure you do that. And you will please God, and you will keep other harm in those areas from coming to you, because whatsoever man sows, that shall he also reap. God is not mocked. Be not deceived. This will happen. Okay, thank you for listening. God bless you, and I'll talk to you again soon. James Lawrence saying goodbye for now.